I come before you today. And there's just one thing that I want to say. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for all you've given to me, for all the blessings that I cannot see. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. With a grateful heart, with a song of praise, with an outstretched arm, I will bless your name. Thank you, Lord. And gave me your light. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. You took my sin and my shame. You took my sickness and healed all my pain. Song of praise, with an outstretched arm, I will bless your name.
Good morning, Christ our Savior United Methodist Church. Welcome to worship this Sunday, August 16th, 2020. This is the day the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it, is what the scripture says. Today we have a choice to really be glad and rejoice that the Lord is with us today and that this is the day that he has made. Because of the fires that we see out in Lake Hughes, it has really compromised our air, because this is the fifth plus month in sequestration, staying in our homes, wearing masks when we go out, and with the tremendous heat that we've had this last week, and we're promised this week that's coming up. So it is a day to choose. It's a day to surrender. It's a day to give our lives to Christ again. It's a day to gather as God's people and be thankful that he is with us no matter what our circumstances are and no matter what is going on in our world. God is still on the throne. You will notice a different background to me today. I am broadcasting from my home office this morning. The reason for that is the church, one of the main air conditioners in the sanctuary, has quit this last week and looks like it might not be able to be resurrected. And so this coming week, we're going to be doing a few extra things to kind of make the sanctuary more habitable for our praise team. And of course, for those, including me, who are leading worship on Sundays. So this morning, I'll be preaching from right here in my office. I've got to have my computer here off my right that'll act as the screen for me to look at my notes from. And because the praise team could not meet this Thursday nor gather today, the sanctuary at 10 a.m. will be easily 85 degrees or warmer. We have selected a set of music that they've done on a previous Sunday. So you will see them in the sanctuary, but they are home, probably watching this as well. And then when it comes around to the sermon, I will be back here with you from my office at home. All right, well, we're ready to get started. So if you join me in prayer, let's go to the Lord right now. Heavenly Father, we are in the world, but we are not of the world. We are experiencing the repercussions of a world that is really topsy-turvy. But Lord, we know that you're not. We know that Psalm 46 promises that you are on your throne, that there is peace in your city, and that you have extended that peace to our hearts. So God, we come to you right now and ask for you to meet with us wherever we are, even if it's at a later time than 10 a.m. on a Sunday morning, and that God, you would be present in our lives, that God, you would reveal to us yourself, and that God, we would be able to divest ourselves of ourselves and fall in love with you again and surrender to you all over, and Lord, let you wash over us. Lord, we need you. We love you. We're grateful that you're here, and Lord, we ask you to come and be our God again this morning. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, let's gather around the songs of our praise team and worship the Lord together.
Okay, here we go.
God so loved.
world that he gave us is one and only Son to save us. Whoever believes in him will live forever. The power of hell will ever defeat it. Now it is well. I'm walking in freedom, for God so loved, God so loved the world. Jesus is waiting, God so loved the world.
All who are thirsty, all who are weak, won't you come to the fountain? Dip your heart in the stream of life. Let the pain and the sorrow be washed away in the waves of his mercy. His deep cries out to deep. All who are thirsty, won't you come to the fountain and dip your heart in the stream of life? Let the pain and the sorrow be washed away in the waves of his mercy, as deep as out to deep we sing. Heart in the stream of life, let the pain and the sorrow be washed away in the waves of his mercy. As deep cries out to deep, we sing, come, Lord Jesus. Spirit, Holy
jealous for me. Love's like a hurricane, I am a tree, bending beneath the weight of his wind and mercy. When all of a sudden I am unaware of these afflictions eclipsed by glory, I realize just how beautiful you are, how great your affections are for me. Oh, how he loves us so.
Oh, how
gift of grace is Jesus my Redeemer. There is no more for heaven now to give. He is my joy, my righteousness and freedom, my steadfast love, my deep and boundless peace. To this I hold, my hope is only Jesus, for my life is wholly bound to His. Oh, how strange and divine, I can sing, all is mine, yet not I, but through Christ in me. Night is dark, and I am not forsaken, for by my side the Savior He will stay. I labor on in weakness and rejoicing, for in my need His power is displayed. To this I hold, my Shepherd will defend me. Through the deepest valley He will lead. Oh, the night has been won, and I shall overcome, yet not I, but through Christ. Future sure, the price it has been paid. For Jesus died and suffered for my pardon, and He was raised to overthrow the grave. To this I hold, my sin has been defeated. Jesus now and ever is my. Chains are released, I can sing, I am free, yet not I, but through Christ in me. With every breath I long to follow Jesus, for He has said that He will bring me home, and day by day I know He will renew me, until I stand with joy before the throne. To this I hold, my hope is only Jesus, all the glory evermore to shall repeat, yet not I, but through Christ. To this I hold, my hope is only Jesus, all the glory evermore to Him. When the race is complete, till my lips shall repeat, yet not I, but through Christ in me. Yet not I, but through Christ in me. Yet not I, but through Christ in me.
Well, welcome back, everyone. We hope that that time of singing was good for you and that you were able to enjoy it wherever you are. If you came in late, you missed the announcement that I am preaching from my home office today because we had an air conditioner in the church that malfunctioned this week that is currently not working. And for myself and the praise team to be in the sanctuary today would be quite warm. So we'll be back next week, Lord willing. We have all our plans in place for it to be up and running next Sunday. So you'll see us back there. But today we're doing it very virtually, very digitally. And I hope the things in the back of my office don't distract you too much. Anyway, we've come to the fifth message in our Scandalous Grace series in the Old Testament book called Hosea. The prophets were pretty serious people who looked at the sin of their people and looked at the holiness of God and were quite disturbed at what was happening with not only the world, but more importantly, his own people who had strayed from him. I read a quote this week from Dustin Benge, who's a professor who said this: if you unhitch the Old Testament from the Bible, if you reject biblical gender roles, if you elevate Jesus' words over Paul's words, if you interpret Scripture through a modern cultural lens and not the original cultural lens that it was produced in, and if you modernize Scripture for the culture, all of these are just new ways of Satan asking the same old question: did God actually say? Now, I'm proud to be part of a church where we believe that God actually did utter the words of Scripture and that we can read it cover to cover and trust that it is God's reliable word. As 2 Timothy 3:16 says, that it's reliable and trustworthy for correction, for reproof, for a training in righteousness. And so we study it diligently, and that's what we're going to go to today. Today is part 5. It comes from the 6th chapter of Hosea. And the title of today's message is A Scandalous Promise. So I hope that you have Hosea 6 in front of you. I'm going to read it right now. And let's see what God's word has to say, and then we'll dig into it. Verse 1. Come, let us return to the Lord. He has torn us to pieces, but he will heal us. He has injured us, but he will bind up our wounds. After 2 days, he will revive us. On the third day, he will restore us, that we may live in his presence. Let us acknowledge the Lord. Let us press on to acknowledge him. As surely as the sun rises, he will appear. He will come to us. Like the winter rains, like the spring rains that water the earth. What can I do with you, Ephraim? What can I do with you, Judah? Your love is like the morning mist, like the early dew that disappears. Therefore, I cut you in pieces with my prophets. I killed you with words of my mouth. My judgments flashed like lightning upon you. For I desire mercy, not sacrifice, an acknowledgment of God rather than burnt offerings. Like Adam, they have broken the covenant. They were unfaithful to me there. Gilead is a city of wicked men, stained with footprints of blood. As marauders lie in ambush for a man, so do bands of priests. They murder on the road to Shechem, committing shameful crimes. I have seen a horrible thing in the house of Israel. There Ephraim is given to prostitution, and Israel is defiled. Also for you, Judah, a harvest is appointed whenever I would restore the fortunes of my people. Last week was a pretty harsh week as we looked at all the prophetic sayings of Hosea, and compare those to our world and what we're dealing with, which is so very similar. That's why we believe in the Word of God, that it's the same yesterday, today, and forever as Jesus is, and that it can speak to us today just like it spoke to them in those days. And it's amazing to see how their culture is so similar to our culture. And not only our church that is, in many cases, the mainline denominations have left the Lord and have come up with their own interpretation of what's going on in the world and so forth, but our nation has done that as well, and it's a sad day. Anyway, today we're talking about a scandalous promise from Hosea chapter 6, and the theme sentence, which I hope you will have found on Facebook, the post previous to this one. You'll see the outline there. The theme sentence is: It's a scandal to take back broken, unfaithful, shameful people, and then heal, restore, and give them abundant life. But that's exactly what God is doing for those who say yes to him. Today we're going to look at four main points. That is to return, point two is heal, point three is live, and then point four is to acknowledge, or as I've said in my theme sentence, to say yes to God. To acknowledge God is to say yes to God, what he has for us and what he wants to do in and through us. So point one is simply here, the word to return. Verse 1a says, return, come, let us return to the Lord. After all of Hosea's cries and weeping and sorrow over what has happened to God's people, he says it's time to return. Come, let us return. It's interesting that throughout the book of Hosea, in chapter 5, verse 4, and chapter 7, verse 10, it says their deeds prohibit a return to the Lord. So because of their sin, because of their rebellion, because of, as Hosea speaks of, their prostitution, turning away from God and turning to other idols and other gods, he says your deeds prohibit a return. In chapter 8, verse 13, 9, verse 3, and 11, verse 5, the prophet Hosea, through God, says, you will return to Egypt, meaning they've returned to the places where God had previously redeemed them. They have returned to Egypt, at least figuratively, to captivity, to bondage. And that's what happens as a result of us rejecting the Lord. That's what happens to us when we decide to do our own thing. We can't return to the Lord. We return to the things of the world. I think it's Peter who says, a dog returns to its vomit. A pig returns to the pen where they came from, and they just wallow in that. And boy, isn't that our experience when we turn from Christ and do our own thing. We're more miserable than we were before. But fortunately, Hosea says, before you return to the Lord, here's some things that need to take place. Chapter 3, verse 5, and chapter 12, verse 6, chapter 14, verses 1 and 2, we need to return. There's some things that need to take place before we return. You know, I was thinking this week about the methods of personal destruction it seems like we, as Americans, tend to engage in when people destroy us, especially seen in social media and in the news media. So I wrote this quote down. In a world where we just want to destroy one another, God wants to restore us, and God wants to help us restore others. I'm reminded of a verse in, let's see if I can find it here, in Romans chapter 12. Live in harmony with one another. Do not be proud, but be willing to associate with people of low position. Do not be conceited. Do not repay anyone evil for evil. Be careful to do what is right in the eyes of everybody. If it is possible, as far as it depends on you, live at peace with everyone. Do not take revenge, my friends, but leave room for God's wrath. For it is written, it is mine to avenge, I will repay. On the contrary, chapter 12, verse 20 says, on the contrary, if your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he is thirsty, give him something to drink. In doing this, you will heap burning coals on his head. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. God is in the process of restoring us, and God wants us to be used by him to restore others. It's so easy to lash out, to hate one another, to say words that are mean to one another. And the Lord, while he judges us for our sin, his first and foremost thought is to return to us. And so that's why this text says, come, let us return to the Lord. I want to show you a video that I picked up last week that is quite telling of what happens to people in our world when they get abused, when we are unkind to them, and when we turn against them. So watch this, and I'll be back in a minute.
I've never actually done a live video before, but it's kind of the way things are going now. The interstate is stopped because of, I guess, a bad wreck. And so I decided to come to the McDonald's at Love's on the Ford Avenue exit. And I waited in line to get my food. I had already done my mobile order so that, you know, people don't pay for my stuff, because I just always like to pay for it myself. But I'm on my way home from work. when I pull up to the window, they hand me my receipt. So I go to the second window to get my food. And I'm waiting. And I'm waiting. And I'm waiting. And so the girl comes to the window and asks me what my order was. I repeat my order and my coffee order. And they asked me to pull up because my food's not ready. It's an English muffin meal with a hash brown and coffee. And I mean, I hadn't eaten since I've been up for a very long time, but I haven't eaten in a while. So I was kind of hungry and I'm still waiting and I'm still waiting. And they asked me to pull up. So I pull up forward and a girl comes out with my coffee and just the coffee, and she hands it to me and I have my window down, and that's all she hands me is the coffee. So I told her, I said, don't bother with the food because right now I'm too nervous to take it. It doesn't matter how many hours I've been up. It doesn't matter what I've done for anyone. Right now I'm too nervous to take a meal from McDonald's because I can't see it being made. I don't know what's going on with people nowadays, but please just give us a break. Please just give us a break. I don't know how much more I can take. I've been in this for 15 years and I've never, ever had such anxiety about waiting for McDonald's drive-through food. So just have a heart, and if you see an officer, just tell them thank you. Because I don't hear thank you enough anymore. All I want is just my next couple days off to just be so chill. No uniform, no nothing. Just for a couple days. It'll get better, I know it will. This will all blow over. But hopefully, it blows over sooner than later, because I just want some McDonald's. I love you all.
That's really a sad commentary, is it not, on our world today and what many of us, each of us, is experiencing along the way. I found Isaiah chapter 1, verse 18, that is in a similar situation that Hosea is in terms of the people rejecting the Lord and not acknowledging him. And Isaiah 1:18 says this, come, let us reason together. And Isaiah says, your sins have been like scarlet, but you will now be white as snow when I deal with you. One of the things that I appreciate about the Lord for us who are Christians is God never wastes anything in our lives, not even our rebellion, not even our bad decisions. He always uses them for our good. If we submit back to him. So the Lord is calling us to come back, to be restored, to be renewed, to reason together with the Lord, which comes to the second point we have, which is to heal. Hosea says that the Lord will heal us, but not until he, as this particular text says in chapter 6, that he cut us into pieces. He says, I cut you in pieces with my prophets. I killed you with the words of my mouth. My judgments flashed like lightning upon you. I have heard it said that if you have come to Scripture and have agreed with everything that it said and have not felt condemned, have not felt poorly for your sin, have not felt like God is a whole lot holier than you and that you aren't, you've not really experienced the Lord. Because God is holy, we are not. He expects things of us that we have clearly not been able to do. In fact, the Apostle Paul says that in Romans chapter 7. He says, the things that I want to do, the things that the Word of God tells me to do, I'm not able to do. I find a war inside of me wanting to do what God wants me to do and finding out that I can't do it. And if we think we can heal ourselves, we have another story coming. It's the Lord who will heal us. It's the Lord, as Hosea says, as Isaiah says, as the Word of God says, that he is the one who will heal us. If you go back to Hosea chapter 2, verse 3, which we covered a couple of weeks ago, some pretty stark words that the Lord says to his people. He says, I will strip her. He was referring, of course, to Gomer, who was a picture of the nation of Israel who had rejected Christ, who had rejected God. He said, I will strip her naked and make her as bare as on the day she was born. I will make her like a desert, turn her into a parched land, and slay her with thirst. Those are words that are pretty hard to hear. Those are words that we just assume not hear from Scripture, but it's a picture of what our state prior to Christ has been like. I was reading ahead, of course, into Hosea chapter 13. And these words, as each week, have been repeated again and again in a variety of places in Hosea. But in Hosea chapter 13, verse 5, we see a really tender-hearted, caring God who is so befuddled by what his people have done. He says this, verse 5, I cared for you in the desert, in the land of burning heat. When I fed you, you were satisfied. When you were satisfied, you then became proud, and then you forgot me. I suppose I could say parenthetically that if anybody out there has forgotten the Lord, has turned from the Lord, has forgotten about the Lord, for whatever reason, that God says, come, let us reason together, let's return to the Lord. I'm eager for you to come back. It's a picture of the prodigal God who has lost both his elder son, who thinks he's got everything together, and his younger son, who clearly has nothing together. And he goes out there and he waits and he waits and he waits and he looks and he searches far and high, far and low for those who are lost. Jesus said that his father would leave the 99 for the one. And that's a picture of how God loves us. But unfortunately, prior to their returning, before their returning, in verse 7 of chapter 13, it says, so I will come upon them like a lion, like a leopard. I will lurk by the path like a bear robbed of her cubs. I will attack them and rip them open. Like a lion, I will devour them. A wild animal, I will tear them apart. You were destroyed, O Israel, because you were against me, against your helper. It's amazing how we can turn against the Lord when he has done so much for us. And yet God comes to us. God reasons with us. Jerry Bridges, who's a favorite author of mine, says this, grace is God's free and unmerited favor shown to guilty sinners who deserve only judgment. It is the love of God shown to the unlovely. It is God reaching downward to people who are in rebellion against him. Franklin Graham, Operation Christmas Child and a Samaritan's Purse executive, is having a march on Saturday, September 26th in the Capitol in Washington, D.C. And I want to show you this clip of him speaking to the Christian Broadcasting Network about what he was going to do and what he hoped that would accomplish. And I think it's an encouragement for us to be praying for our nation. Let's watch.
Thanks for being with us. Franklin, what message do you plan to share in the nation's capital on September 26th?
Well, you know, this, I think for so many people that we are so discouraged at what's happening in our country. What we're seeing in Portland, what we're seeing in Seattle, the defunding of the police departments across the country by many of the city council. It's frightening. And the anarchy that is being produced, and people just, I think for many people, they feel, what can we do? Our nation is unraveling. And I want to encourage people that our hope is not politics. Our hope is not Republican or Democrat or independent. Our hope is in God. And I'm asking people to join me on the 26th of September in Washington on the Mall at the Lincoln Memorial at 12 noon. And let's do a prayer march. Go from one end of the Mall to the other, praying as we go. All of us participate. There's not going to be any special music. There's not going to be a special speakers. It's just all of us marching together, participating together, praying for our nation that God would turn the hearts of our politicians and that he would give wisdom and direction to our leaders. Again, I believe this is the only hope. And this might be the most critical election of our lifetime. So much is at stake. And again, I think only God can change this and turn it around.
Well, I hope that we can put on our own personal calendars and on our church calendar for Saturday the 26th next month to be praying along with the rest of our nation for our nation and for God to speak to us at this critical time in our history. The third point we're going to get to today is that God wants us to live. The sixth chapter of Hosea comes in verse 2 to the phrase that we may live in His presence. It's interesting, God's always wanted us to be in His presence. God has always wanted us to be with Him where He is. This took place, of course, in the garden, and then we chose our own way, and then we lost our way, and we lost our presence with God. And God wants to restore us to that original time of fellowship, of joy, of peace, of love in His presence. God wants His nation to return to Him and to live in His presence. I think of John chapter 10, verse 10, that says God came to give us life. He came to give it to us abundantly. And when we go searching for life apart from Him and in any other place, which we've all done individually and do from time to time, and it seems like our nation is especially doing now, not to mention our world at large, that God is simply trying to restore us. God wants us to be back in His presence. God wants us to enjoy Him. And isn't it interesting that in the Garden of Eden, God said, when Adam and Eve had left His presence, that God said, "Where are you?" Now, of course, God knew where they were, but God said that to express His loss over not being in their presence, their loss of not experiencing the joy that God had planned for them from the foundation of the earth and forever and ever. And of course, that's God's desire for us. Last point we're going to talk about today is that one of the real problems that the Israelites had and one of the real problems our world has is that they simply did not acknowledge the Lord. And as I've said in my theme sentence, I've used the phrase to say yes to God. The first part of verse 3 says, "Let us press on to acknowledge the Lord." The phrase "acknowledge the Lord" appears again and again in the entire book of Hosea. And as you'll notice on your outline, in chapter 2, chapter 4, 3 times, and in chapter 5, the Lord says, "You do not acknowledge me. I'm the one who called you, who set you apart, who redeemed you, and you just have not acknowledged me." And that's what the world is not doing today, and that's acknowledging God, that saying that there is God, that God has something to say about their lives, that God is in charge, and that they'll submit to His leading. And then in chapter 6 here, 3 times, the phrase says, "Acknowledge me and live." God wants us to live with Him, not to die. It's never been God's intention for us to die. It's never been God's intention for us to be separated from Him, to be apart from Him. But it's always, always, always to bring us back into His presence and to experience His joy and, in fact, to live. And then on this whole point of acknowledging God in chapter 8, verse 2, and chapter 13, verse 4, He says, "You will acknowledge me." So it's really a fascinating story in Hosea where God says, "You've left me, and these are the consequences." The intention of God is always to bring His people back. There's always a remnant. There's always a group of people that God especially touches and brings back into His presence. And that's just a joy and a thrill that God is so intent on redeeming His people that He goes to above and beyond what He should do, really, frankly, to bring us back into His presence. I was touched, not this last week, but the week before last, when baseball started. And of course, as many of you know, there was Black Lives Matter occasion at the beginning of the games, the beginning of this shortened season. And I have a story here of San Francisco Giants, Sam Coonrod. And the headline was, "Who refuses to kneel for the BLM movement because he says, I'm a Christian." He says, get it here. Got to change glasses to be able to read this fine print. "San Francisco Giants pitcher Sam Coonrod did not kneel with the rest of his teammates in a showing of support for the Black Lives Matter movement Thursday, saying his religion and his personal feelings about BLM wouldn't allow him to do so. He says, quote, I'm a Christian, unquote, the 27-year-old relief pitcher said, quote, so I just believe that I can't kneel before anything besides God. You know, that's the stance that Daniel took before Nebuchadnezzar That's a bold move. He says, I just can't get on board with a couple of things I read about BLM, how they lean towards Marxism, and they said some negative things about the nuclear family. I just can't get on board with that. Coonrod said he meant no ill will by his gesture and added, I'm not mad at someone who decided to kneel. I just don't think it's too much to ask that I just get the same respect. Boy, those are great words, and it's an encouragement to us that here's an individual who, in the face of great pressure, and I'll post this online so you can see the picture and read the story in more length, but who refuses to kneel for anybody but Jesus Christ. That has been reflected in a number of other professional athletes and a lot of other fairly well-known people, in addition to just regular old folk, as we sometimes call them, who have refused to do anything other than to honor Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. Boy, that's going to be more and more at the forefront of our world these days. So we've got to take a strong stand. I want to show you one last clip here. It's a clip that was filmed by the company that I worked with, that I was the director of productions over back in 1984. You might recall, many of you recall, when I spent 3.5 days in the desert with two other buddies, Dana and Skip, as we were trying to visualize Ezekiel chapter 37, where dry bones come back to life. Ezekiel 37 is a picture of, once again, the nation of Israel who had rejected the Lord, who had not acknowledged him, who had fled from him, and who had suffered the consequences. And the consequences of that were, in God's mind, the picture of a body on the desert floor that was nothing but dry bones. And the question was whether or not God could do anything with those dry bones. You know, the picture for us is, can God deal with our sin? Can God deal with the things that we're facing and we're experiencing? And the picture in Ezekiel 37 was that God was able to bring those dry bones back to life, was able to put flesh on them, was able to put his oxygen back into and his spirit into, and that they would rise and live with him. The video I want to show you is a pretty poor quality because it was originally filmed on film, and then it was transferred to video years ago, and then 5-6 years ago I transferred it to be digital, and then you'll watch it on my screen directly to the web. But the first part of it is a three-screen multi-image production, of which I'm just going to show you one screen because it would be too narrow if I showed you all three. And it ends with this man who's portrayed in the video, who is running from God, and the song that plays with it is you know, how long will you run from the Lord? How long will it be until you return to the Lord? So I hope you enjoy it. And a little, it's basically what we went out to the desert back in 1984 to film for our production to help people come to the Lord. So let's watch this, and then I'll be back to wrap up with a brief comment or two.
O dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. Behold, I will cause breath to enter you, that you may come to life. And I will make flesh grow back on you, cover you with skin, and put breath in you, that you may come alive, and you will know that I am the Lord. And I will put my spirit within you, and you will come to life, and then you will know that I, the Lord, have spoken and done it.
Wake up, people, look at your ways, for your hearts are turning to stone. Ezekiel saw it all so plain in his vision of dry bones. How long, how far will you stray from the Lord? Do you realize the price you must pay to one day be restored? Oh, tell me, what's it gonna take to break your heart of stone? What's it gonna take?
Well, it was a long time ago when we shot that film back in 1984, but the truth of Scripture is still alive and active and still able to penetrate our hearts and our minds. May we ask the Lord for ourselves and for our world to return to Him and stop hiding and stop running and let Him give us life that we may live. I want to leave you with one last quote, which comes from J.C. Ryle. He says this: "Beware the manufacturing of a God of your own, a God who is all mercy but not just, a God who is all love but not holy, a God who has a heaven for everybody but a hell for no one, a God who can allow good and bad to be side by side in time but will make no distinction between good and bad in eternity. Such a God is an idol of your own, as truly an idol as any snake or crocodile in an Egyptian temple. The hands of your own fancy and sentimentality have made him. He is not the God of the Bible, and besides the God of the Bible, there is no other God." Boy, we're so thankful that God has revealed himself to us, has told us about himself, and has drawn us to himself, and what a great reason to rejoice. That's why it does seem to be a scandal to take back broken, unfaithful, shameful people and then heal, restore, and give them abundant life. But that's exactly what God is doing in Jesus Christ in our lives. And praise God for that. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we're so grateful that you have redeemed us, you've called us your own, and that you have promised to be with us forever. Lord, we pray for our world that they would acknowledge you as their Savior and that they would come to you. And Lord, that you would restore us and cleanse us and heal us and renew us. And Lord, give us the life that you intended for us to have. We thank you and praise you in Jesus' name. Amen.
With every breath, I long to follow Jesus, for he has said that he will bring me home. And day by day, I know he will renew until I stand with joy before the throne. To this I hold, my hope is only Jesus. All the glory evermore to him. When the race is complete, still my lips shall repeat, yet not I. I hold, my hope is only Jesus. All the glory evermore to him. When the race is complete, still my lips shall repeat, yet not I, but through Christ in me. Yet not I, but through Christ. Yet not I, but through Christ in me.